It may be too little, too late for Bob Dole, but can immigration and the immigration issue help the GOP hang on to Congress? Tonight on Borderline, we'll see. Can immigration make a difference in the 1996 election? Good evening and welcome to Borderline. I'm Dan Stein, director of FAIR, the Federation for American Immigration Reform. Unless recent polls are wrong, Bill Clinton is the odds-on favorite to be re-elected president of the United States on Election Day. The real suspense is over, but now we want to know, the question is, who will control Congress for the next 2 years? Suddenly, with Congress up for grabs, both parties are making immigration a campaign issue. We'll talk to a former member of presidential candidate Pat Buchanan's inner campaign circle about immigration and Election Day 1996. But first, Therese Kaplan joins us from the NET newsroom with these headlines.
The unfolding naturalization fraud tops the news once again this election eve. A congressional panel this week alerted the governors of six states that thousands of newly naturalized citizens in their states have criminal records. The FBI is reviewing some 50,000 records to determine how many criminals have been made citizens. Out of approximately 15,000 files checked so far, 5,000 had at least one conviction. Congressman Bill Zeliff, a New Hampshire Republican who heads up the subcommittee investigating the naturalization scandal, accused the administration of devaluing U.S. citizenship. Zeliff says the evidence is mounting of systematic abuse of naturalization procedures that place our citizens in danger. An INS spokesman called the charges a reckless distortion of the agency's naturalization effort. Nevertheless, the INS acknowledged that it was reviewing each case in which an FBI file exists. Tuesday is Election Day, and challenger Bob Dole has been campaigning vigorously in California, a state he admits he must win. Both in person and in TV ads, Dole attacked President Clinton's record on controlling illegal immigration. In the state that overwhelmingly passed Proposition 187 2 years ago, Dole charged that the president's lax efforts were costing California billions of dollars in services to illegal aliens.
Late last week, the president tampered with ads of his own, claiming much improved border enforcement and stepped up efforts to enforce employers' sanctions.
Reporting from the NET newsroom, I'm Therese Kaplan. Back to you, Dan.
Thanks, Therese. During this final week of the campaign, both Democrats and Republicans have been talking immigration, especially in California, where 52 House seats are being fought over. Last-minute campaign commercials and carefully timed announcements from the White House are aimed at convincing voters the politicians have gotten the message on immigration. Borderline correspondent Jacqueline Mitchell reports.
2 million illegal aliens in California. 20,000 in our prisons, 400,000 crowd our schools. Every year they cost us $3 billion tax dollars. Bill Clinton has fought California in court, forcing us to support them. Clinton fought Prop 187, cut border agents, gave citizenship to aliens with criminal records. We pay the taxes. We are the victims. Our children get shortchanged. If Clinton wins, we lose.
Having staked his hopes on California, Republican presidential challenger Bob Dole finally hit an issue he believes will resonate with voters. Not to be outdone, Bill Clinton responded with a well-timed announcement of his own to show he, too, is tough on illegal immigration.
For a lot of sort of bizarre reasons, I don't think immigration has really taken hold as a powerful issue politically, either in the presidential campaign or in many congressional races. Part of the reason is a lot of states where immigration is a big problem are not having marquee races. California and Texas don't have Senate races or governor races, for example.
Both parties are sticking to the politically safe message of attacking illegal immigration while avoiding any criticism of legal immigration. Speaking in California last week, Dole had nothing but praise for legal immigrants, saying, quote, "There should be no misunderstanding in anyone's mind that legal immigration is part of what America is all about. Legal immigration. It is good for our country, and it should always continue," end quote.
This is an issue that's going to require a lot more serious discussion that can transpire in a 30-second television ad. And I think politicians understand that. Certainly their political advisors understand that. And politics is not a profession where you routinely throw caution to the wind. There are some aggressive politicians out there who have tried to talk about immigration. Largely they come from districts where that's pretty safe. But those people who represent districts where it's not safe or it's an uphill battle are looking the other way.
Having just passed a major piece of immigration legislation, both Republicans and Democrats know the issue will be back on the table in the next Congress. How much more reform is Congress prepared to make and which direction it goes may hinge on the outcome of some close races where immigration could be a deciding factor. For Borderline, I'm Jacqueline Mitchell.
Thanks, Jacqueline. One note about the report, the Borderline staff did contact the Clinton campaign for a copy of their television ad on immigration, but the campaign was unwilling to give it out. In about 24 hours, the postmortems of the 96 campaign will officially begin. If Dole loses California and the Democrats retake the House, one of the inevitable questions will be, why didn't the GOP come out early swinging on immigration? 2 years ago, Pete Wilson literally saved his political career on the strength of this one issue. Tonight's guest, KB Forbes, an accountant, executive for Creative Response Concepts, and formerly served as press secretary and spokesman for the Buchanan for President campaign, which made immigration its central theme, is with us. And also joining us is Stephen Wagner, president of QEV Analytics. Thanks for being here. First, let me ask you, KB, why did Bob Dole and the GOP wait until what seems to be the last 2-3 weeks of the campaign to come out swinging on an issue that really literally remade Pete Wilson's career and helped the Republicans take the House for the first time in my lifetime 2 years ago?
Well, let me tell you, I was living in California when I saw Pete Wilson was 26 points behind in the polls against Kathleen Brown and came back fighting on Prop 187. Bob Dole does not have an agenda for America. I worked with Pat Buchanan, who had a very clear-cut vision for America, be it on the pro-life issue, be it on immigration reform, be it on taxes or trade policy. The problem with the Dole campaign, they had just one center agenda item, that was the tax cut of 15% across the board. And I don't think that really is an enthusiastic thing for many of the grassroots voters out there. So I think it was a failure on their part to recognize that the Buchanan agenda was a winning agenda, and especially when it comes to immigration reform. That is a very strong issue, and it just amazes me and it baffles me that, one, they didn't use it much earlier starting in August, and secondly, they didn't use the radio airwaves, for example, in San Diego all the way up to Northern California to hit this issue.
So what do you think was the strategic importance behind that? Well, what was their thinking?
Well, it was a last minute thing. I think they knew they were behind the polls. There were no changes after the debate.
Why not talk about an issue that is clearly of enormous concern to California voters?
Because they don't have the bold leadership to do that, and it took them after watching themselves fall on each other after the two initial debates and the disastrous vice presidential debate, they decided, well, we'll do something that might be a little bit more controversial and will give us some profile in California, and that being the immigration issue. I think they should have done it way back in August, but again, you have to understand that Dole wanted to be the moderate element. That's why they didn't include Pat Buchanan in their convention. That's why they did all of this.
Didn't include Pete Wilson.
Well, I know. That's true. And
let me ask Stephen Wagner, what's your take on this? I mean, Pete Wilson's got a 15% approval rating in mid-94. He's way down in the polls. Getting control of the borders, immigration is an important issue to California voters. Here we have a presidential campaign and a Dole campaign, for all intents and purposes, ignores it. Why?
Well, one factor, of course, is that Bob Dole beat Pete Wilson. Pete Wilson ran for president this year, and Bob Dole beat him. And so Bob Dole takes the lesson from that the Wilson agenda doesn't play. He then decides quite late to contest California, so he's not in that California frame of mind. He doesn't take the time to study the lessons of Wilson's gubernatorial campaign in 94. And he picks Jack Kemp as his vice presidential running mate, a marvelous man. But you know how Jack feels about immigration. And Jack took the outspoken stand against 187 in 94.
Okay.
I think Wilson, you know, for all the success he made of the immigration, he failed, too, to take it national. I think the lesson of 187 is that immigration is a great states' rights argument, and Pete Wilson really failed to articulate that, and frankly, I fault him for that. I would much rather talk about immigration reform not on from the basis of being anti-immigrant, but on the basis of being a states' rights issue. We have a federal government that is mandating states spend fantastic amounts of money, particularly California, Texas, and Florida. Of those three, only Texas is solidly in the dole column tonight. We ought to be talking about...
You got to be talking about the issue at all. You know, whether it's states' rights or fiscal bailout or being swamped, you got to talk about it all. But we got to take a break, because when we come back, we're going to talk some more. We want to know what you think, too, about how the issue played out in this campaign. Why didn't the Dole campaign make it a bigger issue? We want to know what you think. You, the viewer, give me a call. Give us a call here on Borderline, 1-800-5000-NET. I'll be back with Stephen Wagner and KB Forbes right after this.
Would it disturb you to know that immigration is fueling over 50% of our population growth? Does it bother you that 83% of all Americans want less immigration and Congress has not responded to their pleas? Would it comfort you to know there is an organization battling to protect your interests? Join FAIR. Let's work together for immigration reform.
We're back. We're talking about immigration in the upcoming presidential campaign. KB Forbes, you had a point about some of the people in the Dole campaign who may have wanted this issue not to be discussed.
Well, I think that a lot of people are hesitant to talk about immigration because they think it's divisive. They're scared of being called nativist and the like, the name-calling.
Fear is a big part of it.
Yes, yeah. And I think one of the reasons the Dole campaign finally decided to go this way was probably from their chief strategist out in California, Ken Kachigian, who is a brilliant man, a cigar-smoking, typing consultant who knew that it takes issues like this to spark the imagination of the voters out there. And I think that's why they finally jumped that way.
Well, Steve, what's your take on this idea that a consensus candidate like Dole, who's used to playing this compromise position, cannot successfully use hot-button social issues and cultural issues in a political campaign without appearing to be artificial or perhaps pandering or even desperate? Is there any merit to that?
Yeah, well, it's no great surprise that Bob Dole failed to seize on one of the many issues available to him to really take to the president. Mm-hmm. It's tremendously frustrating to me as a pollster to sit here and hear people tell me in a thousand different ways that what they care about is the state of our society, particularly the moral character of American society. And this is a cluster of issues that includes immigration, crime, drugs, quality of education, illegitimacy, the inner cities.
Of which immigration is related to almost all those.
Oh, absolutely. It's central. And Bob Dole's tremendously uncomfortable talking about any of these issues. The truth of the matter is that Bob Dole doesn't want to talk about issues. He wants to be elected because he's a good man. And that's a fine sentiment, but the fact is the voters are insisting that their presidential candidates talk to them seriously about the issues they care about. And that's why turnout tomorrow is going to be historically low. Both candidates have conspired to avoid the tough issues.
All right, let's talk to Jerry in Missouri. Jerry, welcome to Borderline.
Dan, I think that bridge to the 21st century is going to be one of those old-fashioned covered bridges. He's covering up his immigration policy, covering his fundraising, covering his welfare policy, covering his education. What do you think?
It's a drawbridge, Jerry. Yeah. What do you think about this question of scandals in this upcoming administration? I mean, everybody's heard about the fact that the Clinton administration is naturalizing thousands of criminals. I mean, rapists, murderers, drug dealers, people like that. And you can't even get the truth. What's the likelihood that might be an issue in the next?
All kinds of old-fashioned Democrats. Tom Wicker, a liberal columnist with the New York Times, saying, "I just cannot vote for this man." Hmm. the scandals, Wicker says, in the Clinton administration are worse than any administration he's seen in his career. And, you know, that puts him up against Watergate and quite a few others, and that's a testament. This is a tawdry administration. Mm-hmm. Let's not be surprised that they're going to use immigration to their advantage.
Yeah, one of the amazing things was the op-ed in the Wall Street Journal by Jerry Zeifman, in which he was the lead counsel of the House Judicial Committee that was overlooking Watergate, and he said, called President Clinton a felon. Called Hillary Clinton a felon. And when you look scandal after scandal, ranging from possible drug use to money going into campaign funds, you're seeing this now happen at the federal level. Because if you look at the history of Bill Clinton's role as governor in Arkansas, we're seeing the Arkanization of Washington, D.C. That is, you make business deals, you make things
the
that are
Arkanization.
Yeah, well, you make business deals.
So Bill Clinton will now be the Arkanship, the Arkanship of America.
But you make it comfortable for business, and then you have business donate in your coffers.
Well,
I noticed,
but Clinton has a remarkable personal capacity for harnessing every issue to his own advantage. Oh, you know, the Republicans passed the welfare bill that cuts immigrants off welfare. Okay, immigrants don't come if they're going to get on the dole. Very mm-hmm. simple, and one would think a pretty popular issue. His campaign, what do you mean, what have they done with that issue, Stephen?
Well, I don't know. They've talked about cutting the children of illegal immigrants off of benefits and have used that with emotional appeal.
To help recruit, I assume, well, yeah. I think new voters among the new citizens, right?
Right.
Well, I think one of the most important things about the last 2 years, if you look at the contract with America, 65% of it became law because of President Clinton's support. And he's running on that. He's running on the contract with America. It's just amazing. But I think when you look at the bottom line issue of immigration, neither party has touched it in a clear, concise manner, and I think it is tragic during this political season that they wait till the last 3 weeks to brew something up.
All right, well, we know from national polls that most of you out there think the country should cut back on immigration, and when we come back, we're going to ask you the question, talk about the question, where does the voter go? If you want to support a candidate that does want to cut back immigration, give us your call, 1-800-5000-NET. I'm Dan Stein. We'll be right back. Let's talk to James in York, South Carolina. James, are you there?
Yes, sir. It's good to hear from you. Good to get on.
Yeah.
I watch you every night. Been watching you for a good long time every night. I'm 73 years old and retired from pastoring, but not to retire from preaching. But getting back to the illegal immigration, it's not only affecting Florida, Texas, and California, it's affecting South Carolina, too.
Yeah.
There's a lot of illegal alien children in our schools. Like, I got my grandson sitting here with me tonight, and there's some illegal alien children in his classroom here in York, South Carolina. And Clinton talking about last summer taking the National Guards and putting them down on the border of Mexico, but I think she'll let the National Guards keep on their job and pay taxes and take the U.S. Army and put them down there where they're trained. And, and not use rubber bullets, use live bullets, and take them by the train loads and plane loads and send them back to Mexico and back to the country they came from. If they can't come legally, let them stay home.
Now, you know, Jerry, I'm really glad you called tonight. And by the way, you're going to have at least four or five more presidential elections to watch, maybe more, and hopefully more exciting than this one. But, you know, on this whole question of the military on the border, I got to tell you, and you heard it here first on Borderline, a story broke just the other day in the San Diego Union-Tribune, and you heard it here first. The Mexican government is deploying Mexican combat troops on the Mexican side of the border. Now, the California National Guard does work on the U.S. side of the border assisting Border Patrol agents, but I just got this information just today from my sources in San Diego. But Border Patrol agents are now seeing Mexican Army units patrolling the Mexican side of the border. Now, one of the things they're doing is they're frisking Mexican would-be illegals coming across to make sure they're not carrying drugs. And they're also confiscating any guns that come back. The reason the Mexican Army is on the border is they want to prevent guns from going to the rebels in Chiapas and other parts of Mexico that the Mexican government is concerned about. But there could be, as a result of this, an incident between U.S. Military and Border Patrol officers and the Mexican military. So, in effect, what I'm telling you is there is a new stage of militarization of the U.S.-Mexico border, but it's Mexico that's doing it. Either you guys got a reaction to that?
It doesn't surprise me. The Mexican government is so corrupt, I wouldn't be surprised if the soldiers were shaking down the Mexican possible illegal immigrants.
But they're trying to stop the importation of guns, is
right.
What's going on.
Yeah, and I think there can be eventually a scuffle, at least between some more of the untrained soldiers. And right now, from my understanding, a lot of those Mexican soldiers are not trained. If not, they wouldn't have a revolution right down there that they haven't been able to control past year.
I would certainly want to clarify. I mean, the Mexican government is not doing anything to help stop illegals coming in from Mexico. They're waving them on in. They just want to make sure they don't have any money or any drugs.
Right.
So, you know, take that for what it's worth. But I think it is a new escalation of the battle. Mm-hmm. I want to get back to this whole question of Jack Kemp's role in the political campaign, though. Stephen, when Jack Kemp was announced, I was in California and talking to a lot of people who'd worked on Proposition 187 and who felt that the Republicans, you know, in a sense, owed this to California. And there was this collective deflation at the announcement of Jack Kemp, that here was a guy, loving the pieces, great guy, he just doesn't get it. What is his position on immigration? I mean, I know he likes to talk about the mythology of how wonderful immigration is. But fundamentally, you know, you've had a lot of dealings with him.
Yes.
On the question of how many people and who they ought to be, what does he fundamentally think?
I think fundamentally Jack's view is that there's no bad immigration.
Period.
And period. And that, he's kind of funny in his stubbornness. And let's give him his due, Dan. In San Diego, I was at the convention also. There were a lot of people who acknowledged the inevitability of Bob Dole's nomination, who greeted with great excitement the announcement of Kemp's selection, because it reinvigorated a nomination that was going down the tubes in a big way. And Republican activists recognized that. So Jack did bring some energy to the ticket. But the problem is that he refuses steadfastly to talk about the issues that are of concern to most people today. And, for better or worse, the issue people care about is not growth. It's what is happening to our society. And immigration is part of that. And Jack regards any talk about immigration reform, any talk about moral decline, as defeatist. And he won't get into it. Well,
but it's what people are thinking about. It's
exactly
on everybody's
so.
Lip. But
exactly
you remember, so. In the early primaries with mm-hmm. Pat Buchanan, didn't the issue resonate in places like Iowa and New Hampshire,
right.
Immigration?
Let's talk about Iowa. In Sioux City and the meat packing companies, you got illegal immigrants there. New Hampshire's not such a problem, but in Iowa, in the Midwest, we have a network of illegal immigrants coming in through the border and springing out to different parts of the country. And Pat Buchanan was the only person talking about it, having the courage to. Now, let's look back
at
those primaries.
Well, the campaign's over, okay?
I know
Pat Buchanan was the only guy doing a lot of things, but the basic point is, didn't the tracking polls show the immigration issues selling? Even the Dole campaign was running immigration ads in Massachusetts and New Hampshire early on in the primaries.
There are a multitude of issues that the Dole campaign has not touched upon, one of them being illegal immigration, the other one being the pro-life issue, third one being trade issue. And I think immigration should have been a cornerstone, especially if you're targeting California months ago. I mean, he's been talking about wanting to win California for months now. He should have made that a center stone. And like I said before, I think it takes courage. I mean, a lot of these politicians, including Jack Kemp, have perfected the art of compromise instead of the politics of conviction.
Okay.
And that's what we need.
Well, a quick answer, Stephen, because we've got to go to break. But I mean, where does the voter go if they want to you know, they want to embrace a candidate who, like Dick Lamb said, we just need a timeout, or Pat Buchanan. Is there any place to go?
No, they stay home.
There's no place to go?
Millions of them will do.
Are you going to stay home? And we would like to know why. Give us a call, 1-800-5000-NET. I'll be back with my guest, KB Forbes, and Stephen Wagner. I'll be right back. We're back talking about immigration and the upcoming campaign. Let's talk to Raymond in Missouri.
You gentlemen, haven't you noticed that this president will even use the border as a means to be able to create a state of national emergency so he can create a situation where he can issue martial law? And as a result, we become a slave to the government and he becomes the dictator. He will use any means he can to become a powerful figure and remain there. Adolf Hitler did it. And he'd take it right out of his handbook. And I'll listen to your comment off the air, and I love you guys. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Okay. Can we attach Raymond's comment to the topic at hand here?
Poor President Clinton. He's going to end up as the most historically inconsequential president since Warren Harding. Much as he desires to be this historic character that the caller describes, it's not happening.
Boy, but Clinton elicits a certain amount of venom among those who don't like him.
Yeah.
Among those who don't agree with him, I guess. He has high negatives.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why is that?
Well, there's a cell of 25-30% of the American electorate that loathes the man, and this is unheard of. Mm-hmm. But the reason is that, frankly, he's tawdry. Things are being said about our president that in an earlier age would have disqualified him from holding any public office, let alone the highest public office in the land. And there's a story there that we elected him in 92 and are poised to re-elect him in 96.
Well, isn't there some merit to the idea that because he was the only man standing, if you will, after the 94 election, he's in a position to personalize every issue. He doesn't really have to share the limelight with a lot of other Democrats, and he's free to range around the political spectrum to occupy the space at will. Doesn't that play a big role in his PR success?
I think he's been successful in part because of the Republican Congress. And like I mentioned earlier, with the contract with America being pushed through 65% of it, prior to this Congress, there was only one big major piece of legislation that he proposed, and that was a takeover of our medical system,
right?
And which was a boondoggle and failed. Clinton is a master at taking credit for all of the good and having a slick and smooth way of outcasting any negative image. We're seeing him here during the John Hwang incident now coming out and talking about...
I'm glad you brought up John Hwang.
Campaign finance report.
To the borderline viewers who may not have been following this, John Hwang, it was a DNC, Democratic National Committee fundraiser, who also was a principal in the Commerce Department, working under Ron Brown, doing fundraising in Asia and in the United States. I'm sure most of you NET viewers know about this, borderline viewers. But what borderline viewers may not know is that there's a link between John Hwang and one of the underlings who was working for him, Stuart Kuo, who was out raising money from Asian nationals outside the United States who wanted to keep the floodgates open of immigration from Asia. Is that unprecedented politically, or is it
well,
we've seen before?
Not unprecedented, but it is a gross loophole in campaign finance law. The presidential campaigns themselves are shackled. The other federal campaigns are shackled with this archaic campaign finance law. The limits on contributions were set in 1976 and haven't been changed, and so the parties are desperate to raise this so-called soft money.
Right.
It is illegal for a foreign national to contribute to a federal campaign, full stop.
But you know, just like the mass naturalization program, when you naturalize somebody, you give them the right to bring in more relatives. If you take the oath of allegiance, you immediately get the right to bring in all your brothers and your sisters and your adult sons and daughters and your parents. It's like selling visas. And if you're out there raising political money for people outside the United States who want to come in, in a sense, you're selling visas. This is what AbScam was about. Those of you may remember AbScam, about selling visas. We've had politicians who've run for office by saying, you give me a contribution and I'll get your brother-in-law in the country, a private bill. This is essentially selling influence, isn't it?
It is. And I could tell you right now, Bill Clinton promised 100,000 police officers. He delivered 100,000 illegal criminals to our streets from foreign nations. And I think,
you got
as
a future
I said before,
in sound bites.
Well, like I was telling you, it is the Arkanization of Washington, D.C. This is, if you read any of the books out there, for example, Boy Clinton by R. Emmett Terrell, where there was an add on recently on the show.
Which you're working on promoting over
well,
your term.
But just looking at what the trend was there, setting up development groups and then having corporations use those development funds to build things, then having those people put money in the kitty, it is the exact same thing. Here we're selling supposedly seats on these foreign trade missions that the late Commerce Brown was selling out to the highest bidder and political cronies. And we're going to hear a hearing tomorrow on this whole issue by the judge who's investigating this.
All right, well, before we go to the next bumper, I have to get Kay Whitecotton in here. Kay, you sent us a fax last week on Georgie Ann Geyer's comments about citizenship. Kay writes us, or faxes us, she says, I think Georgie Ann Geyer is too optimistic. Kay, you say this administration is actively watering down the value of citizenship because there are no limits, no limits, when it comes to this agenda. Citizenship in the U.S. is a small price to pay to be president of the world. This is what drives Clinton. He will fire missiles or naturalize criminals, anything to win. We'll be right back. Hi, let's talk now to Joe in Ocala, Florida. Joe, welcome.
Yes, thank you very much. You fellas are doing a great job. I'm a regular registered Republican, but this year I'm not going for Dole. I'm going for parole. Last week, I called the Republican Campaign Committee in Washington. I told them the only way Dole could win is if he would appoint Buchanan to a special immigration advisory position in his cabinet, and also to make a deal with Ross Perot that he would be the Secretary of Commerce and reverse NAFTA. And I like your comments on that.
All right. Go ahead, KB.
Well, I think that it's important that after this election, when all the pundits are assessing what was wrong, that we again look at the issues of values and beliefs. And one of the most important things here is that immigration needs to be controlled. A lot of these politicians have forgotten that there are essential beliefs that we believe in, and one is protecting our borders. And I think the Republican elite, the Republican establishment, has failed to recognize that there are core grassroots issues that energize the voters, and they will be assessing that for many months to come. And when the year 2000 rolls around, I think the candidates that will emerge or will run will be focusing again on issues such as immigration.
Now Joe's in Ocala, and you know that Bob Dole was raising a lot of money from the Cuban community in Miami, which, whatever their merits are, and they have many, they have very strong feelings about open immigration from Cuba. And what effect does that have, do you think, on the Republican Party's willingness to deal with this issue?
Well, I think, getting back to his earlier question, a signal of a good Republican presidential candidacy is that somebody like Ross Perot is less than 4% of the vote. The fact that Ross is at 10 or better is indicative of the fact many Republicans, like our caller, have found Bob Dole unpalatable. Whether Pat would have found it comfortable being at the cabinet table with President Dole, I don't know. He probably wouldn't have accepted if it had been offered, but a good politics would have had Senator Dole appropriating the Pat Buchanan constituency, which was a terribly important part of the party.
Okay.
One of the groups that's defecting from Dole, by the way, are the religious conservatives that were so fond of Pat Buchanan.
Okay, let's talk to Clinton in Primeville, Oregon. Clint, first time caller. Thanks for calling.
Good evening, gentlemen. I'm sorry I don't have your first name. I just got on a few minutes ago. I got on in time to hear the comment made by Steve about stay home. Don't go to the polls if you couldn't vote for Buchanan or somebody else. I really take exception to that because we got to get these closet communists out of the White House, and we got to get a man honest and lots of integrity in his place.
Well, you know, I think you're raising a very good point here, which is that the for those voters out there who maybe they don't think Dole is exciting, maybe they don't think Dole is particularly animated or that he's even talking about the issues they care about, Edmund Burke did say, he said, private honor is the foundation of public trust. Private honor is the foundation on which public trust is built, basically. Why don't Republicans who just want to see someone in the White House who is capable of telling the truth, why wouldn't they vote for him?
Well, I think what it comes back to is Dole is, as you know, his main issue is trust. I think he's compromised too much. He's voted on both sides of the issue for the last 30 years in the Senate. I think people are not comfortable with him. I think Steve said it earlier when he said, it's my turn, vote for me, I want to be president. People are going to assess again. Maybe they should have focused, and it comes back to values. I mean, Clinton has been brilliant on this. I mean, he's talked everything from the V-chip to giving mothers more time at the hospital. Those are issues that may be not the role of the federal government, but it appeals to the common middle-of-the-road voter.
The average voter isn't going to sit down and do an analysis of the Tenth Amendment.
Right.
If they hear a proposal that's going to affect them positively,
mm-hmm.
Well, that's the end of the inquiry, isn't it?
Right.
We got to get to these calls. I want to talk to Ed in Rock Hill, South Carolina. Ed, are you there?
Good evening, gentlemen. The question I have for you is this. With the immigration situation, of course, we're all racist because, you know, it's a given fact that people that care about this country, we're all racist. So given that point, when you look at how inept Bob Dole has been at articulating anything, I want to go to the bathroom or anything as simple as that, he cannot articulate anything. I mean, if it's immigration, taxes, reform, and his record as far as a legislator, he loves taxes. He has missed a vote to raise taxes. To raise regulations, he is what a cartoonist said, a Bill Clinton light. And to go back to one other thing, my question is this: had Pat Buchanan run with the immigration desire that he had with the four-way candidacy that we have now, what would be the outcome? And don't you think that Ross Perot should be the poster child for why drugs should be illegal, because he's having flashbacks from the 60s.
Steven, you want to take that?
Well, I'm distressed that Ross Perot is at 10%. Sure, I think that's symptomatic of how poor the two leading party candidates are. It's a sorry state of affairs.
You need a third party, do you think? Fourth party? Multiple parties?
I just wanted to address the one issue about racism. The biggest racists you see are the left-wing Latino groups that keep on calling Latinos a race. I happen to be Latino.
You consider yourself Latino.
I am Latino. I am fully bilingual, I was raised in a Spanish-speaking household. My first language is Spanish. And it bothers me tremendously that there is no conservative or Republican group out there challenging this myth that we're some type of race, that Latinos are some type of monolithic group. And if you don't believe me, just ask the president of Peru, Alberto Fujimori, who is Latino but doesn't belong to any so-called brown race. Recently they had that march here in Washington,
D.C. Do you agree with what they're saying now, that most of the Mexican nationals who are immigrating and becoming citizens will vote Democrat?
Yes, I do. I think survey said at 83%, and
I think a lot of those people have been brought out, and they're indoctrinated by a left-wing coalition of Latino politicians. It's a racket, and we need to bust it.
It's a dependency thing, isn't it? All right, we got to take a break, but give us a call with your comments, 1-800-5000-NET. We're going to talk about the campaign issue and the immigration issue right after this. This is Borderline. We'll be right back. Hi, we're back. Let's take some calls. Let's talk to Don in Wiredale, Florida. Don, welcome.
Hello.
Hi, Don. Welcome to Borderline.
Well, I want to talk to Joe in a cow that's about 20 miles north of me. If he wants immigration reform, tomorrow his only choice is Bob Dole. Bob Dole may not be the best speaker, but at least he's not the slick master. At least not the kind of man that lies about everything, that has lied and can go and steal money from foreign countries and do and send his vice president like some kind of courier to take small cash in an envelope in a monastery, and then our vice president declares he doesn't know the difference. I'm telling you, I know that Bob Doe's not the best speaker, but he's the only chance we got tomorrow to eliminate this man. I have passion about this, and I talked to Joe in Ocala, 20 miles north of me. He's about to change his mind. Sure, Ross Perot is a great man, but he has taken votes away from the Republicans, and there's got to be something done about this. This man needs to be voted out of office, and I know he probably, Bob Doe, doesn't have a chance tomorrow. But I pray to God every night for 2 weeks that this will happen. Bob Dole at least said that partial birth abortions will be gone by January. No politician, not even Jack Kemp, will have the guts to stand up and say that he stick a brain through the skull of a child and suck it out in the 7th, 8th, and 9th month. And why not?
Okay, you guys want to react? Quick.
Boy, that was a slam dunk issue. Yet another that Bob Dole gave up on, the partial birth abortion, I think was a major winner, and really would have taken some of the air out of Clinton's balloon.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk to Greg in Daytona Beach, Florida. Greg, welcome.
Good evening, gentlemen. This is more of a comment than it is a question, but just looking at what's going on with the Democratic Party and the president and all the different charges against him and so forth. I used to think that they were that those type of liberals were immoral, but my question really is: are they more amoral than immoral? And I'll just leave it at that and let you guys respond.
Okay, are you going to react to that? I mean, this is sort of Thoreau's comment about the fact that if you abandon moral behavior and a moral structure, you slide from being immoral to just being amoral, that morality ceases to exist.
There's no culture of morality at the White House. I mean, I guess I would give you that they feel that there are very few rules that apply to them. But no, I think it's functional immorality. I think they know what they're doing.
I believe the record shows that Clinton has continually been immoral. Supposedly allegations of affairs, extramarital affairs, building that money machine we're seeing now evolving.
Let's get William from Leesburg. William from Leesburg, Florida. Welcome to Borderline.
Thank you very much for my call. This is a first-time caller. I would like to say that I do intend to vote tomorrow. I'm a registered Republican, but I cannot vote for Bob Dole. I will vote for Ross Perot. And for the reason with Bob Dole is he is just in the same boat that Clinton is in. He voted for NAFTA, and he voted to money along with Clinton to for the troops in Bosnia. And he said he would never do that. And Bob Dole, he cannot tell you anything about the illegal immigrants. They won't stand up and say, well, we're going to stop it one way or the other.
Okay, we got to get some response here for Stephen.
Well, your revenge can be at least that as long as you guys turn out and vote for Ross Perot and then vote for the Republican congressional candidate, that the House and the Senate are going to remain in Republican hands. And that's probably the best revenge we get against Bill Clinton.
Yeah, I agree that the Senate and the House will stay Republican this election. And Clinton works well with a Republican Congress, believe it or not. And secondly, I think it is going to be a reflection, like I said earlier, of values and issues. I think that's what it comes down to, and we're going to see that in 2 years from now, that people are going to be focusing more on issues.
All right, let me a 2 second prediction here. Do you think the immigration issue will build between the next election or dissipate further?
I think it's going to build, especially after January. I think
we're
going to have immigration reform on
the
table.
The whole cluster of issues that immigration is a key part of are going to build.
Okay, well, our thanks tonight to KB Forbes, former spokesman for Patrick Cannon for President campaign, currently with Creative Response Concepts, and Stephen Wagner with QEV Analytics. We want to remind our viewers who watch Borderline via satellite, we are changing our coordinates. We will be available at our current coordinates and on our new satellite, GE1, at 103 degrees, transponder T19H. Next week on Borderline, we're going to take a look at how the election went, get our analysis of where the immigration issue goes in the next campaign, in the next Congress. Won't want to miss it. For the entire staff at Borderline, I'm Dan Stein. See you next week.